What's up, guys? Michael here, bringing another video today. Today, we got my boy, Chris Fagan, on Chew On This. Finally, the return. What's up, Chris? How you doing?
The champion returns.
The face that owns the place, dude. Here we go. About that. Me and Chris are buddies, so this is going to be a slightly different episode of Chew On This. If you don't know what Chew On This is, it's kind of an interview-style show I've been doing recently. It's been a shit ton of fun, but now we got someone that's a good buddy of mine, so it's going to be slightly different because I know a little bit more about him than I do most of my guests. So, Chris, let's just start. How do we get in contact, man? I want to hear it from your point of view. What was it like?
Oh, man. I was so drunk that day, too. I remember running across your channel. I can't remember. Was it that – I didn't know. I ran across your channel first. I made the first contact, if I'm remembering that correctly. And I remember seeing a couple of your – reviews and your so-called reaction. Now the reactions were awesome, and I remember thinking that this dude, for somebody who seems to be so young, knows exactly what he's talking about. This is a guy who's not just doing what I did when I first started off. I did not care about any movies that were older than me and whatnot. I was just moving forward, but you seem to be a young man that was actually going back and studying, and if you haven't seen it, you're soon to see it. You're gonna be involved in these conversations, and I could hear it when I listened to, I think, one reaction or one review that you did. I could hear that in how you presented yourself, and I was like, I can exploit this guy.
You're getting me all touchy feely, and then you ruined it.
But I remember then I reached out and I begged. I was like, "Hey, man, please help us out.
Please come
like,
on the channel, please
help us out." And you were like, "I don't know, anonymous peasant. Maybe if I have the time." And then you graced us with your present. I mean, am I remembering it all correctly?
I believe so. I think it was because too. We were on the same Facebook like movie review page or whatever, and then there was like a post. Everyone shares their channels.
Mm-hmm. That might be how I came apart.
Yeah, and that's exactly. I think that's how it happened. And ever since then, we've been best friends. That was about like a year ago, right? Roughly.
Yeah, roughly
like a year ago. Yeah. So it's been a year, and we're still good buddies. And we're gonna go all the history of Chris Fagan here, man. We're gonna go way back when you were a youngin. Let's talk about when, if you could point to a time. I like to ask this question a lot. If you could point to a time in your film history where you're just like, movies. I love movies. This is my thing, man. This is my passion.
I remember, and that's funny, I presented the same question to another, I don't know if she considers herself a critic or a pundit, Miss Movies, and I was trying to follow their podcast, and they said, send us questions, and I was hoping that they would read it out loud, because this question was very important to me. So your question is about the movie that, when did I get involved in these, into all of this, or if the question was what was the movie that changed the way
if you could pick one movie, or a moment, like an age or a moment in the film. Yeah,
it's
maybe
it's definitely
it's
a movie.
All right, but let's hear it.
That's the way I presented the question to them, and they never answered it. So
now you got your chance to answer it yourself.
So the movie that changed the way I see movies was Clerks. That was the movie.
Okay.
I don't know how old I was when that movie first came out. I was a fan of just the regular stuff, you know, just anything that was blowing up or anything that had guts and blood and stuff like that, you know, the typical guy action stuff. But I remember I worked at, no, we went to our local Blockbuster. I'm going to call out how old I am that right now. My local Blockbuster with my mom and my brother, I think every Thursday we would go to Blockbuster. And I would see this box when it was still VHS. I saw this VHS tape. Very old, and it had Clerks. It just was basic little artwork, had some guys on the cover, just said Clerks in all these different colors. Nothing special. I would pass it by. I don't need to see that movie. I remember seeing a trailer for it once, and it stuck in the back of my head. I never rented. I just kept passing it by. Rented every action movie that I could find. All when I had nothing else to watch, I've watched them all. I came down to that movie. I said, okay, let me finally see what this damn movie's about, and it changed everything. The way I think I said this on my podcast, I became the guy that I am today. I think my sense of humor, the way I see film, the way I see pretty much everything, is probably the Force was awakened when I saw that movie. I remember one specific scene that I rewound for 30 minutes straight. The scene only lasts for like a couple of seconds, but I rewound that one part until 30 minutes, almost to an hour had passed. And I'm still in the beginning of the movie and I was stuck on this one part. And Kevin Smith, that dude there, and I learned everything about him. I started learning more about what it means to be a director. I started finding more interest in things like that, lighting and how movies are being made. Cause I heard that he maxed out all of his credit cards to make that movie and put it all on the line, and it worked out for him. And I followed all of his movies since, and that just opened everything up for me. And I was hooked on film and how it's made, and became a more appreciative like fan, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Yeah. So diving more into that, now you have your YouTube channel, you have a podcast, right? Which right. I'm a part of your YouTube channel, by the way, for all you fans out there of me, go to Chris's channel right now.
The
go
third amigo. Right, I like when you say that.
Third amigo right here. Let's talk about how you met Sean, the second amigo. I'd like to hear that story.
Oh man, that battle royale. I met Sean. Sean is, we have mutual friends. A friend of mine named, also named Mike, I've known since, it's been like 17 years. And I remember going to a Christmas party at his house that him and his wife were having. And I think I met Sean there at one of the parties that he was having. And there was some kind of an instant click there. I think I don't know if we started speaking of movies, but we probably did, knowing us. But he also knew that other Mike for years, longer than I've known him. And that Mike, you know, brought us together, and I don't know how, but then we started gaming together, and in the gaming sessions, me and Sean would notice that for years, whenever we would talk about movies, or if the conversation ever went from the games we were playing to movies, me and Sean were always just carrying on. And Sean would say something like, he'll tell you the story better than I can, but he'll say that I'm the first guy he's ever met who was able to quote certain movies or know what the hell he was talking about whenever he just said a random movie. And I would be the first one to go, that was Mission Impossible or something like that, or that was some comedy, that was Princess Bride, I know that quote, or something like that. I was the only one that he's ever met that was able to keep up with his randomness. And I know all of our other friends hate it, so we were trying to focus on other topics, but me and Sean we just had a movie connection. And a couple of years ago, what was it, 2015, I think, and we decided, you know what, maybe we can, you know, do this on YouTube and see what comes of it. And we've been doing it ever since, so it's been pretty badass.
It's been awesome. Yeah, man. So what made you want to take the move, not necessarily a move, but more of another avenue, rather, between doing your YouTube channel and then podcasting now?
Being the type of guy who sees other people doing it, you know, big, and thinking, okay, maybe that's how what I should be. I don't know. I never thought about podcasting at all, but I think maybe it was John Campy. I'm a big Collider fan. I remember watching one of his videos that teaches you how to get into YouTubing and podcasting and whatnot. And he emphasized that it was all about, you know, sound quality and whatever before the visual stuff. Sound is more important. And I just kept hearing in the back of my head, you know, podcast this and podcast that. And I thought, you know, whenever I have time, maybe I'll do it. But then I thought about it. I'm technically doing that now. I mean, we're recording a video. If these cameras were to turn off right now, and it's just, we're podcasting pretty much anyway. So I was like, what the hell am I waiting for? So I thought I was just wasting time not doing it, if that makes sense. I should have been doing that a long time ago. Another person that I'm a fan of, another channel I'm a fan of, is I mentioned earlier, was Miss Movies. And she regularly as a team do YouTubing and podcasting separately and simultaneously. And I think that was the moment, like sometime last year, when I realized, you know what, yeah, I need to get into this, because I'm probably not flexing the muscles as much as I should be, as much YouTubing as I like to do. There's probably something about just... It's something freeing. I don't know if you've done it at all, but if I recommend it, if you're a YouTuber, you should also consider doing some podcasting, because it's something freeing about not having the camera on you, and it's just you and the microphone. It's Agreed. Almost like you're just having a phone conversation.
Yeah.
And I feel like I'm free to be naked and to lather myself with the various
of course,
things. Just shoot from the hip.
Of course. So going back to you and Sean now, I'm curious, have you guys ever fought or gotten to argument? Because you guys have been friends for a long time, you know?
Have we ever fought like, you mean like on a movie topic fight, or if we ever like thrown down? Because Sean's way bigger than me. I'm not fighting him.
Oh, no. Not thrown down, because, yeah, Sean's a big guy. So in terms of just arguing, man, have you ever guys got heated at each other at all over anything?
We've allowed our estrogen levels to kick up a little bit. We act like little sissies about certain topics or something, and we'll do the passive aggressive thing. The one thing that Sean can say to me that will always get under my skin is, "All right, don't get your panties in a bunch." And that's what I'm like, even if I don't react, I'm like, that is just the way he says it.
Son of a bitch. Yeah.
It gets to me every freaking time. But there's been times where we've had like maybe a heated discussion or a topic that we probably shouldn't have even been talking about before. And we've never raised our voices or anything like that. Sean is the kind so level-headed, he's probably not doing what I'm doing. And when I'm alone in the house, if I'm mad about something or upset about something, I'm like acting the whole thing out, like pacing around the house.
That way too, slamming the doors, screaming.
Putting words in their mouth of that, like things that they're probably not even thinking. And Sean's probably sleeping at home like a baby, and I'm like saying, "You said what to me?" And there's like things that he's not even saying or thinking or whatever. But face to face or on the phone, whenever the conversation gets kind of heated, Sean's the first person like to kill it. He's like, "Well, all right, man, forget it." And he just ends it right there, and he walks away. He's better than me.
he's a great guy. I love Sean. Hopefully after this, maybe one of these days we'll get Sean on here too, and we'll have a 3-man booth eventually.
Well, but don't get it wrong. But whenever Sean's the kind of type of guy that like loyal to a fault, he's the kind of guy who will give you the shirt off his back if you need it. But if you cross him or his friends, he's got your back. Oh, he'll
raise hell. Yeah,
he raises hell if necessary. But he's so cool and calm. Unlike me, I'm so damaged up here, man. I make a mountain out of a molehill out of everything, and then I'm the kind of guy who can't let it go, and to the point where I feel like man to man, I have to talk to you. Like, okay, let's talk about the little disagreement.
We have a problem here, sir. He's like, "What problem? What problem?"
Exactly. And that's exactly how it happens. I'm like, "Let's talk about what happened yesterday." And he's like, "That thing that I haven't thought about since?" Yeah, okay. Let's talk about it. And I'm like, it makes me feel like a lamer friend. No,
forget it. Forget it.
So I got to do better. I got to be better friend.
All right. So on that front, let's talk about your other passions. Because not only are you a big movie guy, you're also a big gaming guy and WWE guy. So let's start with wrestling. When that start? I'm curious.
Oh man, probably since the womb. You'll be surprised to know the person who got me into wrestling was my mother.
Really?
A huge WWE fan. And I'm 37 years old. Oh man, I can't believe I'm that old. But back in the 80s, I was born in 1980. So back in the 80s, you know, the options were all those independent circuits. Before the WWE became what it is today, it was the WWF, and there was a whole bunch of other options. And then when the 90s came, it was WCW and whatnot. I never watched anything else but World Wrestling Federation. I was a big Hogan fan and whatnot. And then when it started to expand and become something more, and WCW, the Monday Night Wars, I still never watched anything but the WWF. Even when they were losing in the ratings, I never watched one episode of Monday Night Nitro or any of the other shows. I stayed with them all the way through, and it's my mother who got me into it. I mean, my mother was into who did she have a crush on? Bret the Hitman Hart, Shawn Michaels, and to a point where whenever they would come to Houston, I don't know how she did it. This is before the internet. I mean, you have to call Ticketmaster on the phone, really? And you had to like hold your spot. And she would always get us the best seats. And then all of a sudden it started to get, you know, more intense. Like all of a sudden now we were getting backstage. She was getting autographed pictures and whatnot. And then one day She even dated a wrestler, a guy from Houston. Yeah. It was a guy named Ahmed Johnson. Yeah, you got to look this guy
up. You're kidding. She dated Ahmed Johnson? Are you serious?
Pearl River Plunge himself.
And, wow. That's insane.
She dated Ahmed Johnson for a little bit. We went to his house a couple of times while they were dating. Joined them on a movie date one time, me and my little brother, and talked about wrestling all the time. I learned a little bit about the behind the scenes stuff a little bit, but yeah, I've always been a true fan, and it's all due to my mother. Oh yeah, and one time when Ahmed brought us to one of the pay-per-views, we were front row. I don't know if he was the one who hooked us up with those tickets or if it was just my mom, but I remember that was when Ahmed Johnson was with the Nation of Domination, if you know about
those Farouk guys. And all that. Yeah,
Farouk gets in the ring, and I don't know if Ahmed told him about, you know, my girlfriend's out there in the front row or something like that, or if he even considered her a girlfriend at the time. But for some reason, Farouk gets into the ring, and he's like, you know, he's got his straps on his wrist, and he's just looking around. He sees my mom, and he's just like looking at her for like this, like real intense, like smiling, like that grin, until a total stranger that was sitting next to us was like, "I think Farouk is looking at you, ma'am." And she was like, "Yeah, okay, how you doing?" And he's like really like really giving her the eye, and I'm like looking at him like, "You son of a bitch,
I'm gonna do something."
I was gonna do something. I was like a little kid. So wrestling has been all a part of my life, and I like talking about this stuff. I love the new guys. I love the new direction that it's gone to. I got to meet a lot of those guys when I worked overseas. Vince McMahon, what's his name? John Cena. All those guys. I got to meet a lot of my heroes, I guess, when I worked overseas. So wrestling is huge, and up to this day I still love it, and I'm hoping that we can do something on the show about it a little bit more. So
definitely two-part question here now about wrestling. First part being, who's your favorite superstar growing up, and who's your favorite superstar currently?
Favorite superstar growing up, the Hulk Hogan was just the easy answer, but now that the more and more I think about it, the person that I spoke about the most, more than Hulk Hogan, because when it was Hulk Hogan, that was because that's the guy who was being marketed the most. So as a little kid,
it's like John Cena, basically,
he couldn't help it. He was like the Mickey Mouse of the WWE, the WWF. But when I became like 9, 10, 11, who did I speak about? Shawn Michaels. Shawn Michaels was the guy who, even then, I probably criticized the WWE the way I criticize movies now. Even at that age, I was thinking to myself, Shawn Michaels' character, or if there was character or not, it being a little short guy compared to all those other big guys, he's like a giant killer. He took down Diesel. He took down Sid. He's the only first guy to be the first one into the Royal Rumble and to win. He's number one in, and he won the whole thing. He first guy to win it twice, and all those little things. And if you add up that guy's career, Shawn Michaels was the most, even with all his issues. Like, I know that he was a hothead sometimes, with Bret Hart and all that stuff. When he got down to it, he was very professional. But all the things that he achieved, and this was before I switched my loyalties to The Rock, but all those things that he achieved was amazing for a guy of his size and his charisma and everything that he brought to it. That all amazed me back then. So yeah, Shawn Michaels was the first. Currently, I guess that was the second question.
Yeah.
Who's my guy? Who's the guy right now? Dude, that's a tough one. I'm still trying not to pick one of the old guys. I'm gonna try to pick one of the new guys. Oh, dude, that's a tough one. My friend Joe would have a better answer than me. Who, you know who's my favorite superstar? And I mentioned this on this channel, on my channel.
You're taking over.
And I'm about to mention it on this channel. My favorite WWE superstar is Sasha Banks.
Yep, I remember.
That's the one. I may be, well, now I might be wrong about this, but my prediction back then was, I feel like she's going to be the first female superstar to be the face of the company. And I feel like she still could be.
There's still hope. I don't like where they're going with the character, but there's still hope.
Exactly. And that's a shame because that's kind of what they always do to some of the female characters. But at the same time, you don't know what's going on behind stage. And, until you watch an episode of Divas. Are they still calling the show Divas now that they've stopped calling them Divas?
They're still called the old Divas on the show, though. Yeah.
Weird, but
very weird.
I know what it means. But yeah, she's the one that and I never thought I would say this because back then, you know, the Divas were like the joke. That was the time to get up and go to the bathroom was when the girls were wrestling.
Yeah, that was the bathroom break. Not anymore, man. It's crazy. Yeah.
They couldn't crack the code of the getting the strong athletic ones and whatnot, and that was believable to then be also still attractive and whatnot or feminine or and whatnot, which is what the guys want. They couldn't find that perfect, you know, Goldilocks zone, and now they have
a good batch of female wrestlers right now, man.
They're very athletic and they can be very, you know, beautiful at the same time that's starting to even go away. I mean, the stereotypical beautiful thing is I think more and more starting to get, you know, they're starting to focus more on the story, and I appreciate that. And I think Sasha Banks is just one cog in that machine that'll help bring it to the next level. So she's one I'm looking at and very entertained by. I love that character or that person.
Do you have a lot of time though to watch it? Like, do you watch NXT and stuff, or are you just a Raw and SmackDown guy?
I'm mostly Raw and SmackDown. I'm trying to watch more NXT. I'm doing ever since what Finn Balor came out. I'm thinking to myself, I should have been watching NXT from day one.
Dude, his matches in NXT were insane.
Are incredible, and
you gotta watch it now because Shinsuke Nakamura, Bobby Roode, like these guys that you would never think would ever come to WWE. Austin Aries, like what the hell?
And I'm not caught up, and I'm so old school thinking with the SmackDown and Raw thing that I'm missing out on some great stuff. So I have to force myself to watch it, but I'm not consecutive on the NXT thing. And for some reason, I'm being very discriminatory against the the Cruiserweight new show.
Yeah, 205 Live sucks, man. I'm sorry.
Okay, so it's not just me then. Okay.
No, it's horrible.
Okay. That's what.
Which is so weird because they got guys that got really good talent on there, but it's just like
they just need to come to Raw or SmackDown.
The show is just so boring. Like, I can't even get into it at all. It's so laughably bad.
Oh man. Oh, speaking about laughable, Booker T, you know, since I'm from Houston, you know, since Booker T's from Houston.
Yeah.
You see the local commercials with Booker T. What, there's a guy who does a mattress commercial or a furniture commercial, and his catchphrase is I think something about it's like, is it that's the fact, Jack? I think, but like, he's like, oh, that's the fact, Jack. But now you see, he says it in his funny voice. But now Booker T's doing a commercial with him, and with that gravelly voice of him. He's like, we got sofas and we got beds, and Booker T's in the background. Tell him about it. I love Booker T. So, man, anytime I see a wrestler on TV, I'm gonna stop and I'm gonna just be entertained because I love these guys, man. They're awesome.
So I'm assuming then you haven't watched like New Japan or Lucha Underground or anything, just because you're a Raw and SmackDown guy.
Nope. I'm strictly Raw, SmackDown, and the pay-per-views for $9.99.
Oh yeah, the WWE Network with all those originals. Holy Foley
for $9.99. I like that show. I'm worried about his daughter though, because she's a legacy. She has the talent and everything, but I'm thinking that I don't know. I don't know if she'll make it, but I'm hopeful for her. I think she'll be a superstar whenever they decide to let her in the ring. Holy Foley is a good show. I don't like watching all the original stuff. Some of them are great, but Holy Foley is a good one.
I gotta check it out. So what do you think about the direction we're going in toward WrestleMania? Cause that's the big one coming up next. Fastlane is coming up, and then we got WrestleMania. We just got past Elimination Chamber, all that stuff. So.
I gotta see Fastlane first before I can call any predictions on WrestleMania. I got to check out Fastlane because I'm trying to see what they're doing with Goldberg. I'm thinking they're gonna do. I for some reason I feel like they're gonna do.
I'm so scared that Kevin Owens is gonna get squashed by Goldberg.
I feel like they're gonna do another Batista thing where you think he's coming in just to get the belt real quick and then just give it up, you know, so he can go back to doing what he was doing before. But that didn't happen for Batista. He was on
They wanted him to do it. Then Austin, everyone just booed him out of the place. So they just stopped the whole thing.
So I'm wondering if that's in the cards for Goldberg. I don't know. Just saw that I saw on Twitter today that Naomi is was had to relinquish the belt.
Such a bummer, man. She deserved it too. She's such a bummer.
And that's the thing. That's why I don't want to call it for WWE for WrestleMania, because I think that's happening a lot more than it used to happen. I know people get hurt and whatnot, but it's funny how I feel like maybe there's an uptick on when a person finally gets in that place where the WWE is ready to take a chance on them, like the way they did with Edge and all these guys back in the day. And then later on, they would get injured. But now it's happening, I feel like, a little too soon, where the very first time that they get that belt, the very next day they have to, or week, they have to give it up because of an injury. And so I'm like wondering why. Maybe I'm just paranoid, or maybe I'm just not seeing what's really happening. But I feel like there's like some kind of an uptick on injuries whenever a person who's been trying for so long and never given a chance, finally gets that shot.
Happened to Naomi. It's crazy.
Maybe it's a coincidence, but I don't know. I'm hoping maybe it's a part of the storyline. But
if it's like a Finn situation, man, that's a bummer. Or a Seth Rollins, man, he got hurt out of nowhere. For
real. Yeah, I feel like it's happening a little too. I know injuries happen all the time, but I feel like it's always when that person gets that to a certain level or gets that belt for the very first time. That's when that bad luck hits, and that sucks, man.
Oh, yeah, totally, totally. What's your favorite finishing move out of pure curiosity?
Still, it's still the rock bottom and the people's elbow.
People's elbow, yeah.
As ineffective as that elbow thing is, it's still the funniest thing to see him wind that up and finish that move. No, what's my favorite finisher? My favorite finisher? Yeah. Is it the people's elbow? You know, for a long time, it was the pedigree for some reason. But I don't know, man. I'd say it was the I'm going to call it like, you know, if there's a Batman, Superman, Wonder Woman, a trinity of finishers, it's the Stone Cold Stunner, the Rock Bottom / people's elbow, and the pedigree. Those are my top three. I'm going to just give it to those three.
Mine right now, I know you're not watching NXT, but mine right now is Shinsuke Nakamura's Kinshasa, man. That thing is fucking insane, because literally he can hit it in the corner, mm-hmm. when he's on the top rope, when he's running at you, when you're stationary. Like, it's insane. I mean, literally, they got to make Kinshasa out of nowhere shirts. Not even the RKO anymore, man.
So is it like the RKO out of nowhere situation?
Kind of. It's imagine, like, remember the clothesline from hell that JBL used to do?
Oh, yeah.
Imagine that with just someone lifting their whole fucking leg up and just like kneeing you right in the fucking face.
Okay, I'm gonna have to YouTube that one. And that's all. He's on NXT. Is he like the champion or just a dude?
He's not the champ. He just lost the championship to Bobby Roode, man. So, but you gotta check him out. He's crazy. He has a match with,
what's it called?
The Kinshasa.
The Kinshasa. I'll look.
The Kinshasa. It's insane.
Send me a link to that. I'm gonna look that one up.
Definitely, man. Definitely. Now that we're gonna save the WWE talk, just in case we get the Bros to WrestleMania thing going again.
We'll on save the Bros to WrestleMania. Yeah, we gotta get
that. We'll save it for now. So let's move into the area of gaming, man. How long have you been a gamer? Because I know since I was like 4 or 5, man. PlayStation 1 and onwards.
Oh, that's my mom's fault again, man. Ever since she spoiled us relentlessly. Me and my little brother were such little whiners about having all the toys and whatnot, so we didn't go outside that much because we had the Nintendo. Then we also had the Sega Genesis simultaneously there, and then when it evolved to the Super Nintendo, we had that and the Sega still, and with the Sega CD. And in each one of those consoles, I remember we had at least 30 plus games for every console that I've ever owned. While I was still living in my mom's house, and that just carried on. When I don't consider myself a real gamer, a guy who really loves games, but to this day, I became an Xbox guy. When everybody was coming to PlayStation guy, I was like, fuck that, you know,
PlayStation.
It's all about I wanted to be an Xbox guy because I wanted to be different. I just feel like I thought that the Xbox was gonna because it's gonna win that war, but you know, it's pretty even, and I don't think one's gonna knock out the other anytime soon, so I might get a PlayStation. But a game that I used to suck at was Call of Duty. Now that's the game that I'm addicted to, so all day, every day, anytime I can get on Call of Duty and or now Battlefront and just tear stuff up. But right now I'm playing I'm about to get into Resident Evil.
Oh man, I am like this close to finishing it. So it's worth it, man. You got to go through the whole thing.
You want to know where I'm at on the game?
Where are you at? Tell me.
I'm still literally at the beginning where you enter the house for the first time.
Come on, man. The game's been out for like a month.
It's been out for a month, and I got it then, and it freaked me out. The second,
dude, if you think that's scary, just fucking wait, man. Honestly, it gets worse.
I'm gonna be waking up screaming for the rest of my life until the day I die. I don't know why. I've never been such a little punk about these things, but now
that game is terrifying, man. No, I'm not knocking you at all. That game is terrifying.
And I haven't even seen anything scary yet. I just heard something in the background. I heard, and I'm like, nope.
Fuck it.
That's Netflix. Bill Burr. Like, yeah, look, just laugh a little bit, you know? So, I haven't gone back. So, I need to play it.
You need to play it, man. And then we got to do like a full episode just talking about how fucking scary that game is. It's a horrifying game, dude. Horrifying. What else are you playing right now? I know you mentioned Call of Duty and Battlefront.
What's that? Resident Evil, and I've been playing the new Final Fantasy game. I'm loving that game. I've been playing.
Really, I haven't. I just haven't got a chance to play it. It's good.
And it's been a long time since I played Final Fantasy games, man. But I forgot how much time those games takes, and those side missions and whatnot to level up and power up to get through the story. If you want to get to the storyline fast, you got to do the side stuff. So. I forgot about that. I mean, I got kids now. I'm like, before I was married, I was playing those games. I was knocking them out, man. So
Final Fantasy, 12 hours, not that bad. Come on. Yeah.
So you know what? I'll be honest. So now I'm playing old school Sega games like Sonic and stuff, because that's what my son likes to play. So now he's got, I bought him for his birthday the Disney Infinity.
Disney Infinity. Yeah,
those Disney Infinity things, and I only because you know they discontinued it, and it's huge discount. So the little characters were like $20 each. Now like $4 each. I bought them all, and so that's what I've been playing, because that's what he wants to play. So that's the games I'm playing. Little kitty shitty game. Right?
yeah. Disney Infinity 3.0. There you go, man.
3.0 all day. Spider-Man.
What do you think of? Because like I said, I haven't got a chance to play the new Final Fantasy. I know a lot of people are complaining about it, though, because the new combat system. What do you think of it?
You mean for the like the side missions when you go off and fight the little creatures?
Well, no. Because I know now it's not like a turn-based thing. It's all like real-time hack and slash combat. So what's that like?
I haven't found anything upsetting about it because of the fact that I played those types of games. So I thought that was neat that they introduced they incorporated this this more co-op feel to it, and I just looked at it like, because I haven't stuck with the Final Fantasy games throughout. There's only been three Final Fantasy games I've ever played, and that was Final Fantasy 8, and then I forgot which one this was. Was it 10? I think Final Fantasy 10, and then now this one. And only because each one of those the storyline looked so different from all the other. If a Final Fantasy game came out that felt like Final Fantasy 7 to me, or the older games, then I would skip it, because I feel like, you know, you guys do that all the time. But when the characters or something just stuck out, and I'm like, they're doing something different again, I'm gonna get this game. It was the car that I saw. I said, oh shit, you get to drive a car now? So that's why I bought this
one. Which a lot of people are complaining about too. I don't know what that's like at all. So
because it runs out of gas and you gotta push it, and that's some bullshit.
Really? That really actually happens? It runs out of gas?
Run out of gas, yeah. So that's a crazy thing. So yeah, you gotta watch your gas, you gotta watch all that stuff, and like little stupid stuff, but I find it entertaining. So I haven't looked at the reviews.
Yeah, on the other end of the spectrum, I'm also playing a very Japanese game, for lack of a better term, Yakuza 0 on the PS4. Mm-hmm. And that is like the most weird game I've ever played in my life, because it's the main storyline is about, obviously, like the Yakuza, the Japanese mob, and it's very serious. But then at the same time, I don't know if you guys have it in Texas. Do you guys have Korean barbecue in Texas?
Yeah, there's Korean barbecue.
So, like, literally, you could, like, walk down the street, instead of beating guys up, go eat Korean barbecue and go on a date. In the game, yeah.
Oh, wow. And this is like a role-playing game.
No, it's like a beat-em-up game. Like, imagine like Final Fight, except in 3D completely, in Japan, good graphics. And it's like so fun. But you could go on these side things where you go on dates. You could go to the batting range. And hell, the game's even made by Sega, right? So guess what you can do in this game? Takes place.
I'm thinking about that crazy taxi thing.
Yeah, so you could go to an arcade in the game.
Okay. And play old school Sega games.
And you could play old school Sega games in the arcade.
Wow.
And the newest Yakuza, not Yakuza 0, which is the one that we just got, Yakuza like 5 or 6 in Japan, you can play all of the Virtua Fighter 5, the whole game in Yakuza 5 or whatever it is. Holy crazy.
Shit. I haven't played Virtua Fighter in a long time. Oh,
yeah, man. I'm more of a Mortal Kombat guy, but that's still crazy that you could even do that, you know?
Oh, you shouldn't have said that. Oh, now the challenge is being thrown down now, bro.
Dude. That's
my shit, dude. Reptile. All
really? Time. Reptile's your boy in Mortal
Reptile
Kombat?
Reptile is the boy.
What about my main in the new Mortal Kombat X, dude? I love Kenshi. That is such a fun character to play.
Who am I in the new Mortal Kombat game? For some reason, I'm pretty good with Katana. I've never been good with her, but for some reason,
yeah, that was me in the last iteration of it on the PS3. Mm-hmm. Dude, I kill with Katana and Kung Lao, tag him in and out. Over, it's over, man. Those are probably like the two of the cheapest characters in the game, probably.
I like the fact that they brought Jason Predator and who was it? Did they bring Michael Myers? Am I thinking that?
No, it's Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Leatherface.
You had the license last on the last game. Bring Freddy into this thing, man. It would be perfect.
Imagine Freddy versus Jason in Mortal Kombat, dude. That'd be so sick.
Oh man, it would be the best thing. Oh man, it would probably be the movie we should have got.
Yeah. So you're a big Mortal Kombat guy then, right? Huge?
Big, huge.
What's your favorite iteration?
You mean the movie or you mean out of all of them? Like
out of all the games, what's your favorite game?
I thought you was like asking what was my favorite, like any, like I love the out of the games, my favorite game would probably be Mortal Kombat 2. That classic game is still because even with those 8 or 16 bits that they had, or 32 bits or whatever that they had back then, they pushed it. And they, it's funny how when you look at those old Nintendo or Sega games in comparison to what we play with like right now on our cell phones, those graphics were like teeny tiny, man. They took up like maybe a little sliver of space compared to the games that we play nowadays. Yeah. But back then, it blew your mind away. Like it looked real. So that was the one that made me open up and go, yeah, gaming is going to be huge in the future, man. I can't wait to get these graphics. These guys are really pushing it. So the blood and all that stuff and the comedy. Yeah. So part 2 is still my favorite. The first movie is still my favorite, the live action version of it. And I used to love the Mortal Kombat cartoon.
There was a cartoon of it for a while. That was pretty fun too.
Yeah. Which was, I think it was on the USA Network and it was linked to all the other there was one episode that was linked to all the other cartoons that were on that network at the time.
Really? Interesting.
They had a Savage Dragon, Mortal Kombat, and I forgot the other shows that they had lined up. But there was one character who was leaping through portals and going through all of those cartoons.
Cool.
They did an expanded universe before that was even a thing, and it was Mortal Kombat. That was kind of cool.
Man, MK is such a cool game too. For me, I remember I had a PlayStation 1. One of the first games I had on was Mortal Kombat Trilogy, which is basically Ultimate Mortal Kombat 3, like on crack though. Like you had literally every single character. You could play as like Mataro and Shao Kahn like right out the gate. It was crazy.
You mean the Ultimate Collection? Was it Ultimate Mortal Kombat 3 or what was it called?
In arcades, I believe it was Ultimate Mortal Kombat 3, but when it came to
Trilogy on there, didn't it?
PlayStation 1, it was Mortal Kombat Trilogy.
Trilogy. I remember that. Had all the characters. It was exclusive to PlayStation, right?
Yeah, and you could be anybody. Noob, Smoke, Rain, everyone, dude. It had all the color swaps of all the ninjas and whatnot.
All the stages, yeah. I played Trilogy one time, and I love that one. That's a good one.
That's a good one. Moving back to movies now, we're in 2017. The night or the year is still young. The night too. I don't know why I was gonna say
the year's still young.
You're still young. So, any highlights so far? I love to ask this because I'm curious as to what you've liked so far in the year of movies.
A big surprise that I just saw, Get Out. That was
me
the
too.
One that really blew me away, only because of the fact that it was written and directed by a person who's only known for comedy.
Yeah, Jordan Peele.
And he really crushed that. As far as, okay, so what else has blown me away? I don't know. The fact that this Crow remake is never going to get made is really tricky. Other than that, the films that have come out, February, we're still in February. What is good? Anything good come out in January? Not that I can think of.
I liked Split a lot in January. Split was really awesome.
Split surprised me. I'm very hopeful for the future. I don't want to spoil it just in case.
Yeah, nobody wants to come in.
Exactly. But
literally every single guest I've had so far this year has been like, Split's ending makes me so hopeful for whatever that next movie is by him, man.
Exactly. And I read somewhere that he never was into like doing sequels that much, but when he decided to do what he did on this, I don't know, man. I guess he got humbled a little bit after the bad luck, I guess, that you want to call it. And it's kind of cool. You put that dude under a small budget. You make them have to flex that imagination. Dude, M. Night. I know you forgot. It's been so many years that we've been making fun of him.
Yeah.
He's been crushing it. So, yeah, you're right. Split and Get Out. Those are my two big ones this so far.
Dude, let's talk about Get Out for a moment. Because I saw that last night as well. Mm-hmm. Drove almost an hour to go see it with my boys. Four of us went to go see it, and we were so hyped on this movie, unbelievably. And we walked out of it thinking that was literally the perfect movie. I literally, in my heart, I feel like that was one of the best movies in a long time that I've seen. Really, truly.
I feel like he crushed it when he talked about like certain things that as Black people we think about, or just minorities probably in general and whatnot, we think about and we sometimes say or we don't say or whatever. But it was funny how I think I was sitting right next to Sean, and Sean was sitting on the other side of Sean was his other Black guy. It felt like the stereotypical Black guy who's like talking to the screen, "Don't go in there, bitch."
And what you doing? All that stuff.
Yeah. Like, I told your ass not to. Like, you didn't tell him anything, okay, sir? He can't hear you. It's a fucking movie. Like, relax. But Sean was. I noticed that when a certain thing was said, like, or a certain thing that the boyfriend would say to the girlfriend about that like those I told you so moments or the setup for any kind of a tense little awkward conversation about race and whatnot in their relationship, I noticed that a lot of the Black people in the audience would be like 5 seconds ahead of the rest of the audience for some reason. And now maybe that's just me or something, just seeing more into it than what it was. But it was very well written. You can tell, and this is a thing that I appreciated from this movie. And I'm not saying that every movie, like if a movie is like Wonder Woman, like it has to be written and directed by a woman or whatnot. That would be cool and whatnot, but I don't feel like I'm not that kind of guy. Like if it's a movie about a black guy has to direct it or something like that. I feel like that's, it depends on the subject matter, but I feel like this subject matter, you could tell if this is going to make sense. You could tell that this movie was written by a Black guy, or in Jordan Peele's case, a biracial guy. Cause you could kind of tell, cause it was the emotions that he tapped into and the awkwardness that he tapped into was like, to me, dead perfect. Like it was exactly like, I kept saying that to myself a lot. That's exactly what it feels like, or it's exactly what that awkward moment feels like for. But who knows? I mean, I just hope that the movie crushes, because it's coming out this Friday, isn't it?
This Friday, this upcoming Friday, it's coming out.
I hope it crushes, man, because that movie, everybody needs to check that out. You know, so big up to Jordan Peele. You knocked it out. So you got definitely. My vote.
Also, totally curious, because I myself am a minority, but I'm Chinese. So, and everyone I went with, most of the theater, because where we live, you know, it's a total mixed pot here in Los Angeles. So you have people from every race here. Curious to say, how did they handle, in your opinion, the race relations, I guess? How did they handle the awkward situation? Did they feel true, or did they feel exaggerated to a point? Or
so I think the thing that he knocked out perfectly, because it's not the first time it's been done. I mean, what's her name? Zoe and Ashton Kutcher. I think they did that remake to Guess Who's Coming Home to Dinner. That movie called Guess Who with Bernie Mac before.
Bernie Mac.
They, I mean, at the very beginning of that movie, they even, spoiler alerts, they even talk about this almost the same subject. Does he know that I'm white? You know, since it was reversed, and it was almost the same setup. Like, no, you know, he does it. He'll find out when you get there or whatever, right? but because it's not a big deal, or it's not supposed to be a big deal. But I feel like this movie captured that conversation, because I've had that conversation before. It captured it perfectly, because some guys are just more, I guess, more upfront about it. Like some guys will just straight up ask their girlfriend, "You told him I'm black, right? Like, I don't want to walk in no situation." Like, all right.
Yeah.
You know, it's his daughter. You know, he's going to be thinking things, and he's going to look at me, and he's going to have a flashback, and it's going to be bad. Or some guys will do it the way we saw it in the movie, and kind of,
Did you tell him I'm black?
The way he kind of like, forget it. Let's not talk about it. I've had those conversations. So it's, I feel like he grabbed that perfectly. And it speaks to the actor too. So if he's been in that situation before, who knows? But the way he portrayed it, it was exactly how I felt it for, if it makes sense, I felt it for him. I was like, oh my God, I was having a flashback. Oh my God, I can't believe I dated that girl. I felt it for him. It was like certain situations.
There was a moment that totally related to me. Like I said, I'm not African-American, so I wouldn't be able to speak on it, but there's a moment without
knowing not?
I know. I look like one of those Chinese.
You're my brother from a different mother, though, right?
But anyway, there's a moment in the film where he tells the girlfriend something about the housekeepers, for lack of a better word.
Right.
And then she goes, "Oh, I need to go tell my dad about it." He's like, "No, please don't. You know, please don't." Yeah. That's such like a real thing. Yeah. You know, thing. Yeah.
This is us talking like now. Like, don't.
Yeah. If you don't need to bring everyone else into it. That's such like a real moment and a real conversation that like I've had with friends or my girlfriend, whatnot. You know.
Right. You don't want to know that they're probably now thinking about that new issue that was just
exactly
because you know he's not going to say anything at dinner, but you know he knows now, and it feels awkward, and he's thinking, is he thinking about it? Because you're right, that was another one of those moments where it's like, yeah, no, don't say anything, I'm talking to you in confidence, like,
yeah,
don't say anything. I've had that conversation before too.
Really neat movie. I really it's my favorite movie of the year so far. I gave it my perfect score, the highest score I've ever given movie, A+. I loved it. Nothing wrong with it. I gave it a perfect score, man.
If I'm gonna rate it, maybe a 9.9 or something.
It's that close. Yeah.
That one. I felt like that deer could have been more realistic. No.
You talk about deer realism. I don't know if you've seen it yet. Have you seen A Cure for Wellness yet or no?
Not yet.
You plan on seeing it?
When I first saw the trailer, it felt like Shutter Island. And then and then I started hearing the reviews, everybody's comparing it to, one person even called it the poor man's Shutter Island. I was like, nope, that's it. Probably not going to see this
movie. I'll endorse it. I really enjoyed the movie, but I'm bringing up the deer. There's a horrible CGI deer in A Cure for Wellness. It grinded my gears so much because the whole movie is like all practical effects. The set is built, you know, and everything's all nice and pretty. And then also see the CGI deer, man. It killed me.
Oh, looks looking like something like George Lucas did.
Dude, it literally looks like something from like late 90s, early 2000s CGI.
Oh, wow. That like did it like jump or something? Like you could tell the editing was
bad. This is not like a huge spoiler. You could see it in the trailer. They run over a deer, okay? Right. They run over a deer, just like Get Out almost. Mm-hmm. Except this deer doesn't die immediately. So what happens is it gets up after they hit it, and it walking the way it walked, I know it was injured, so it's like flopping all over the place or whatever, but it just looked so horrible. Like it was the worst thing I've ever seen. That's like right at the beginning too, within the first 15 minutes. I was just like, man.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah. I always say, man, yeah, just hit a real deer, man. You go for the realism.
Just
worry about Peter later, man. They'll be fine. There's plenty of them out there, man. Bambi's mother prepared us for this, so we need to screw it. But yeah, I know what you mean. That can take you out of a film, and I hate it when it's so obvious that it just pulls you out. He's like, I'm going to the bathroom. I'm get some popcorn or something.
Yeah, that's why I'm really hesitant in seeing The Great Wall, because I've heard that it's just a CGI fest of a film.
I've heard one person that I respect say that it was not as bad. I think he lowered his expectations. That it's not as bad as it thought it was going to be. It was actually a pretty decent film. But then after it started to continue, then it was like, oh, okay, nope. Yep. Now it's as bad.
I've literally heard every reviewer say the same thing. It's just like the first half of it was awesome.
Okay. That's
the
product.
Building up the universe, right? And showing the Chinese army and then Matt Damon's character, and they're all coming together. It was awesome. Awesome. But then right when like the fighting starts, it just like, falls apart completely. I'm like, That's the exact opposite of what I thought it was going to be like.
Yeah. Well, action, you thought that the action was going to be the redeeming thing about
exactly.
it.
Exactly. And the storyline was just horrible, but really it's the other way around. It's crazy.
So you've already watched it. So you said you found yourself saying, I wish this action movie had more dialogue or just kept talking or something.
I haven't seen it, but that's what I've heard from a lot of people. Oh, okay. But you know what? I felt that way about John Wick 2. That was what I felt about John Wick 2. I felt like the first one was overabundance of action, while the second one was a overabundance of dialogue and a lot of world building, which was good, but I felt like they took it a little too far. So when the action came, it was very, very repetitive. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Yeah, so.
I'm sorry, I'm looking for a power cord right now. I'm trying to play it off, but I got that warning to plug your laptop up. So I'm gonna do
it's all good, right? You got some time. Well, I asked the next question here. Now that we're in 2017, like I said, any movies like you're super hyped for? Apart from Logan, because that's the one everyone's talking about in these next coming weeks. Apart from Logan, any movies you're looking forward to this year coming out?
Apart from Logan, I don't know if the editing on that got me coming back up from the bottom.
It got you at the last second.
Like, anything you're excited about? Well, glad you asked. But let's see. You took Logan away from me? Come on. This is not fair. This is hard now. Let's see. Let's see. I'm not looking forward to Transformers. I'm definitely looking forward to Spider-Man. I'm looking forward to that.
That's what everyone's saying, man.
Everybody's wondering about whether or not I'm actually hearing people thinking that it's not going to be good. I'm like, what the fuck? Come on. No. He's going to be in Infinity War, so it's got to be good.
I don't know if the trailer to me didn't completely sell me, but I have faith. I have a lot of faith in this movie. You know what I'm saying?
I predict that the scene that was in Civil War was happening in the middle of this movie that we're about to see because of that trailer.
Interesting.
That we
Interesting.
Saw that. You remember this? Did you see?
Yeah, I've seen the trailer. Yeah.
You saw this? Okay, so you remember the trailer, and then you remember the TV spot where it was like what is that? And he's like, wait. He's like, what? That suit you're wearing? And he's like, this is my suit. And he was like, no.
He's like, no, toss that out.
Got something. Think like I thought when I saw that, I was like, what, think about that.
Because, dude, you may be onto something. You're right, because
in Civil War, he had a nice suit.
And he had the eyes and everything. You know?
Exactly. But when he met the friend, what's that guy's name? What's that character's name? Oh, Happy.
Happy.
When he met Happy, he was wearing his old busted suit that what's his name? Robert Downey Jr. told him about. So I'm thinking that they're gonna show him getting his suit for the first time, and then it's gonna cut to, and then and then I had to go help Mr. Stark out in Germany, and then now I'm back in school, and maybe they're gonna cut to him in high school thinking about that, and that's why he was in school in class, just sitting there thinking about. That's why I'm excited about this movie, because I want to see if my theory is right because of that TV spot and what happened with Civil War. If it's gonna be like a flashback, him sitting in class thinking about what he was doing a few minutes ago and how he got his suit.
That's so interesting. I haven't heard anyone talk about that yet. That's a really good theory.
That's mine.
Don't let anyone steal. You can make a video on it like right after this. Don't let anybody steal it from you.
Seriously. Oh, I'm sure somebody thought about it. But yeah, I should probably talk about it. But yeah,
that's definitely my theory. So as we're closing out here, I'm going to ask you a couple key questions I like to ask everybody that comes on here. First of all, if you can pick a favorite movie, what would it be?
Like my all-time favorite movie.
Definitely.
Okay. Oh, man. I'm sure that's always the response. I'm sure people always have that one right on the top.
It's always either immediate or
or drawn out one. I already knew that because that's how I'm the latter. I'm the guy that's gonna go, ugh, I'm gonna disrespect this movie to show love to this movie. And which one would it be? I don't want to be I'm probably gonna have to just say Clerks, since that was the one that started it all for me on the path that I'm on right now. I would probably say Clerks. I probably wouldn't even be here right now if it wasn't for that movie. So,
yeah. Interesting. Favorite movie. Okay. What do you feel like on YouTube or through podcasting? One, have you reached your goals? And if not, what goals do you look to achieve?
Oh, 1 million subscribers. No, I guess the goals that I'm looking to achieve is to be the kind of guy who can walk into a bar or something and not have to pay for a drink. That's what I want. I want to be like, hey, aren't you that guy? Like, yeah, now buy me a drink.
I'm that guy. Like, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And I want to make it awkward. I want to ask them to buy me the drink. I want to imply that they were about to tell me they were going to buy me a drink. That's what I want to do. That's how cool I want to be. But honestly, I just want the goal to be an official, I guess, outlet for like for what we do, like an official source, maybe. I don't want to break news or anything like that, but I want to be to a point where I don't know if there's a number for that on the subscribe level, but to a point where people are like quoting you on another news or YouTube channel. You know, it's interesting today because Chris over there talking T3 Media, is he was thinking that if I ever get into that situation, then I'm gonna feel like I made it.
Complete. Yeah, okay, interesting. What are some tips that you would give to someone who wants to start up something like this? We're talking about movies or TV, wrestling, whatever, man. What would you give some tips to them?
Like, do not think that you're going to just fall right into it with 2 million subscribers in 2 weeks, because you'll burn yourself out and get frustrated. If you have any small little voice in the back of your head saying that, you know, that this isn't really what I want to do, or I don't really have that much interest in this, this is just a flavor of the week kind of a thing, like, don't even start, because to do what we do, you have to really have a love for the thing, I guess, that you're trying to do on YouTube. If you notice that you're the kind of guy that's always talking about it, to the point where your wife, like my wife, is always like, if I say something funny, she goes, "What movie did that come from?" If it could be something that I made up, and she'll still ask me, "What movie did that come from?" I'm like, damn it. So if you're that kind of a guy, then whatever it is, then you probably are on the right path. Stay consistent. You know, consistency is the key. You know, don't get frustrated and burn yourself out because you think that you're going to be a hit in like 3 seconds. No, just do it because you love to do it, because it'll show. It'll show to the audience that you really care about it. So, and then the good things will come eventually, you know.
Agreed, that's, brother. Awesome, man. Chris Fagan, T3M's king right here. Anything you want to plug, man, before we sign off?
Oh man, I want to give a shout out to Soulja Boy, and I know that they had to cancel that fight. I will fight you. No, no. If you want to just check me out, yeah, I'm right here on YouTube. T3 Media is online. YouTube.com/T. Is it T3 Media is online? And you can find me on Twitter and Facebook. T3 Media is. We just love to talk about movies. We're just fans of this stuff and all of the TVs and the binging and all this good stuff, and we just go crazy over good films, not sucky shit. We want good stuff. But anytime you want to talk to me, or anytime you want to reach out to me, yeah, I'm open. I'm an open book. Ask me anything, you know, pick on my bald head, I don't care. I'll find you eventually. So anytime, any place, movies, I will be ready to talk about it and throw down.
Awesome, man. Awesome. Chris Fagan, everybody. Thanks for coming on, buddy. It has been a great time.
Outstanding, bro. Appreciate you. Always, yeah, man. Amigos. Sure.
That's right. I'm Michael, guys. Thank you for watching. Obviously, if you're on my channel, then you know who I am. Hopefully, if you don't, now you do. Stay tuned, guys. Subscribe, like, comment. That's how I'm able to get awesome guests on, like my boy Chris. We just had on A to Z Reviews. He's awesome. Art's awesome. Josh McCuga. We've had a great bunch of people come on this show, and it's been a blast. So please keep on supporting the show. Keep on sharing it, liking it, retweeting it whenever you see it on the Twitter, whenever you see it on Facebook. Anyway, guys, I'm Michael. Stay tuned for more Chew on This, more movie reviews coming up soon. We're saying peace. Later.